Hello and welcome back. Last time I said our next task will be to play the sound generated by the plugin in real time, through the speakers. This is going to be developed in two steps. First, we want to write a program segment that interfaces with the audio driver and feeds, so to speak, the audio driver with sound data. The audio driver I am referring to here is really a chain of several components. At the end of the chain, there is a hardware device, but that is obviously not the one we will be talking to. Rather, it will be an audio client interface the operating system provides. In Windows, one such interface is called WASAPI. I hope I pronounced that right. On the Macintosh, the equivalent interface would be Core Audio. But since my computer runs Windows, in this tutorial, I will be focusing on the WASAPI audio client interface. Okay, I'm going to take a shortcut here. Rather than writing all the code myself, I'm going to borrow a function I found in one of Microsoft's help files. It is this one here. In the VST plugin host program, it looks like this. Audio device is a class that basically encapsulates that single function. And this is how it works. I won't stop at every line of the code, just concentrate on the important bits. The audio client interface is activated. And then the plugin host program and the audio client enter into a negotiation phase as to what audio format to use. I need to know the audio formats the audio client supports and hope that the format I want to use will be among them. The audio client can operate in one of two modes, shared mode or exclusive mode. I found that on my system, if I wanted to use this format here, which is a PCM format, with samples per secondum equaling 44,100 Hz, then I had to initialize the audio client in exclusive mode. After that, the next major step is to get a buffer from the audio client and fill the buffer with data. LoadData is a function I have to implement, and I'll talk about that a little later. After the buffer is filled with the data, it is released to the audio client. Picture this as the shared buffer going back and forth between the audio client and the plugin host program. Now that the first set of sound data has been handed over to the audio client, actual playing can commence. And then we enter this loop, where the audio client is asking for more data at regular intervals, and we give it the data which is being produced by the plugin, and I'll show you where that is done in a minute. And this goes on until there is no more audio data left. One more thing to point out is that whenever a set of data is released to the audio client, our program goes to sleep for about the same duration as it takes to play that much sound. To make this work as seamlessly as possible, only about half of the buffer space is used at each iteration of the loop. So this is our interface to the audio device. As I said before, the audio device is asking for data, more than that, demands data at regular intervals, so let's see where and how that data is supplied. It is in the LoadData method, of course, which lives in a class I created called AudioSource. Before you get excited, in this version of the program, AudioSource is not getting the sound data directly from the plugin. Instead, it is reading data that had been previously created and saved in local memory when all MIDI events were processed by the plugin. Remember, last time when we created a WAV file, the plugin's output was written to the WAV file. This time I added a line where that output is also saved in local memory. That memory is in audio source. In a vector. You can pause the video and read the code at your leisure. I just want to show you that in Play MIDI Tune, after all MIDI input has been processed, the Play Audio Stream function of the audio device is called, and we should be hearing the music played through the speakers. So let's see if it works. Again, the plugin I'm using for this test is VSTX Synth, and the MIDI test file is also the same as last time. Did you hear it? I hope you did. I also have a longer MIDI test tune. I run the program with that one. As you can see, it is much longer. Uh-oh, that didn't sound good. This test tune has chords in it, and the VSTX Synth plugin can't handle more than one note at a time, so no polyphony. I think it's time to ditch VSTX Synth and look for more interesting plugins. I collected a few, and I'm going to run through some of them. It will be interesting to see how the plugin host program stacks up to them. This is a Yamaha synthesizer plugin. This is such an old plugin that the DLL main entry point is called main. So I also have to edit this line. I can't hear anything, can you? Okay, so this didn't work. Let's try something else. The next plugin is a 64-bit plugin, so I need to compile for 64 bits. Another error. Damn. Never mind, more to come. Same thing. Okay, I'm not going to waste more time by showing you failures. I tested some other plugins and they all failed. But here is a spoiler. I already fixed the errors, and in the next video I'm going to show you what went wrong. This, by the way, is a fairly common scenario in plugin and plugin host development. There are bound to be errors, because our understanding of how things should work or expected to work don't always coincide with that of those programmers whose programs we are interfacing with. But don't get discouraged, there is always a solution.